Hi, my name is Luke Harmon, and I am happy to talk to you today about a macroevolutionary research program. This is going to be a short lecture introducing my course in comparative methods that goes along with my textbook, which is available at www.phylogeneticcomparativemethods.com. I'm an associate professor at the University of Idaho, which is where I am right now to bring you this lecture. And this lecture will be a 20-minute overview that explains the motivation for our studies of the tree of life. Have a look at the nine creatures on this slide. These creatures differ from one another in extraordinary ways. From the hammerhead shark in the top left to the cassowary in the middle right. Probably my favorite creature of all of these vertebrates to point out is in the middle of the bottom row. It's easy to forget how crazy frogs are. Imagine that you'd never seen a frog before and you're introduced to one for the first time. Their distinctive body forms, behaviors, and ways of life make them stand out completely from other species on Earth, even their close relatives. Just look at this waxy monkey frog and tell me that this thing doesn't look like some kind of creature from outer space. All the species on this slide, including our frog, are members of a single clade, the vertebrates. So this extraordinary diversity of animal species that we see today all descended from a single common ancestor. We can see that both through similarities in their body plans and similarities in their DNA sequences. All of this information about the relationships among organisms is summarized in phylogenetic trees, which show how species are related to one another and how they descended from common ancestors. All the species on Earth are connected to one another in a single phylogenetic tree, the tree of life. It's only in the last few years that we've been able to get a more clear picture of the entire tree of life and how all species of Earth are related to one another. This new view of the tree of life is very exciting. I compare it to this object here, which is the Hubble Space Telescope. The Hubble Space Telescope famously allows us to look at objects that are extremely far away from us in the universe, like this planetary nebula. When we look at these objects that are far away in the universe, the light that comes from them has had to travel through space for millions of years to reach us, and so, in fact, we're also looking back in time. Our new view of the entire tree of life is similar. By knowing how all species on Earth are related to one another, how they descended from common ancestors, and how their traits have evolved, we can learn about deep time from the tree of life. And that's the theme of this whole semester's worth of lectures. What you're going to be learning about in these lectures is how exactly we can get information about deep time evolution from the patterns that we see in the tree of life. The simplest way to frame most of the questions that we're interested in along these lines is how are there so many species on the Earth, and why are they all so different from one another? So most of the methods that we'll encounter this semester boil down to these two basic questions. But we're also interested in one question in particular, I think, which is any of this predictable? In other words, if we know about how evolution works and the starting conditions, can we predict how the course of evolution will take place over time? One way to start out this discussion is to ask the simple question, how fast is evolution? Everybody knows that evolution is slow, glacially slow, so slow that it would take longer than a human lifetime to observe it. At least, that's the common knowledge. This goes along with the stereotype of evolutionary biologists as digging up fossils like this trilobite to try to understand evolutionary patterns over deep time. Sometimes a well-placed fossil like this early bat can be very helpful in telling us something about evolutionary patterns. But fossils are rare and hard to come by. And in fact, the stereotype of evolutionary biologist as a sort of Indiana Jones-like character is not quite accurate. So what if we want to know about rates of evolution, but we don't have access to any fossils? Maybe we haven't found them, or maybe the group that we're interested in doesn't have any fossil record. Well, in an ideal world, what we might do is simply think about the trait values that a species have over time. So here's a plot that has trait value on the y-axis, time on the x-axis, and we take a measurement of a species at a certain time. We then watch that species evolve over time, and we can see the track that it makes. Perhaps we have intervals at which we sample our creature and take measurements. And between any two of those intervals, we can calculate an evolutionary rate by simply noting the difference in trait values from the beginning to the end of the interval, that's delta x there in the plot, and the change in time, delta t. Our rate is then the amount of change divided by the time period over which that change occurs, delta x over delta t. And we can do that over many different time intervals. We can start out with an example from the tetrapods. These all descended from a common ancestor between 400 and 350 million years ago. You can see their relationships here. And it turns out that one of the best examples that we have about evolutionary rates comes from the tetrapods. And it comes from these tetrapods in particular. This is the large ground finch, one of the species in the genus Geospiza. These are the Galapagos finches. And these birds have been studied intensively by Rosemary and Peter Grant in their natural habitat in the Galapagos. Here's what some of the data from the Grants research looks like. This is a 30-year time series of evolutionary change in the traits of two different species, Geospiza fortis and Geospiza scandens, beginning in 1970 and going through 2001. And you can see three different traits plotted in this figure. From top to bottom, we have body size, and beak shape. And what you notice if you look at these plots is actually an extraordinary amount of change, even over a relatively short time period of 30 years. And again, we can look at this time series and we can calculate evolutionary rates by looking at any of these intervals and finding the difference in traits divided by the amount of time that's passed. Here's an example of just one generation's change in these finches. And it turns out that despite the stereotype of evolution being extremely slow, there are tons of examples of scientists that have been able to measure evolutionary rates, both in real time, like in Darwin's finches, even in the lab over a few hours with various microorganisms, all the way back through deep time using fossils, like this crinoid. So what do we learn from these studies? This is a famous plot that was made by Phil Gingrich in a paper that he published in Science. On the y-axis, we have evolutionary rate. And in this case, evolutionary rate is measured in haldanes, a unit which I'll describe later, but still boils down to an amount of change divided by an amount of time. And on the x-axis, we have the time interval in generations. Notice that the time interval on the x-axis is in log 10 units, meaning it spans a range of time intervals from 1 to well over a million generations. When Gingrich was compiling his evolutionary rates, he broke them down into four categories. First, we have experimental rates of evolution, which is rates of evolution measured during experiments, either in the lab or in the field. And although I haven't told you much about this y-axis, the rates of evolution from experiments are extraordinarily high, fitting with our knowledge from the Darwin's finches. He then added to that plot data on historical rates of evolution, so rates of evolution over historical time in recent human history. Microevolutionary rates, so these are rates of evolution that are measured over a little bit longer times, where, for example, skeletons are preserved back a few thousands or tens of thousands of years. And paleontological rates, measured over hundreds of thousands to millions of years. What you see, though, is that all of these evolutionary rates fit within the same narrow regression line of evolutionary rate against time interval. This is really an extraordinary pattern. And what we see is that evolutionary rates are fastest over the shortest time intervals that they're measured. In other words, evolution is faster the closer you look. I think it's worth zooming in a little bit on one particular example of rapid evolution just to give you the flavor for how fast evolutionary change can sometimes be. This is a famous study on bacteriophage. This is PhyX174, a virus that attacks bacteria. What I want to tell you about is a famous experiment on this organism showing both rapid and predictable evolution. In this experiment, that was published in 1999 in the journal Science by University of Idaho researcher Holly Wickman and her colleagues, they report a study of adaptation of bacteriophage to a novel host. The cool thing about this study is that the experiment took place in two different labs. One at the University of Idaho, labeled ID in this plot, and one at the University of Texas at Austin, labeled TX in this plot. That was in Jim Bull's lab. The experiment took place over 9 days, during which the bacteriophage adapted to its new host that it hadn't encountered before. And we can see evidence for that adaptation on the y-axis of this plot, which shows the growth rate of the bacteriophage on its host. In both cases, the growth rate of the bacteriophage starts out low, but by the end of 9 days has increased considerably. You might also notice that the time course of this adaptation differed between the two locations. In Idaho, the bacteriophage adapted rapidly and then plateaued, whereas in Texas, there was a bit of a lag before adaptation proceeded. The really remarkable part of this experiment, to me, is shown when the researchers then went in and sequenced the genomes of these bacteriophage to see how this adaptation took place. What we see here is the mutations that occurred during adaptation in both Texas and Idaho. In the first column, we see the site in the genome where the substitution took place, and in the right-hand column, the corresponding amino acid change. Texas, the 15 mutations in Texas are on the left, and the 14 mutations in Idaho are on the right. So we can see exactly what mutations are taking place and substituting in our population over time. Remarkably, though, many of these adaptive changes were shared across the two sites. In fact, 7 of them were matched between the two sites. So you can see them connected, those matching mutations connected by yellow lines here. The order of those mutations substituting was different, but over half of the mutations that we see in the experiment are shared between the two places. And that's what this shows is that evolution can be very rapid and predictable under some circumstances. It turns out that Holly Wickman, who's my colleague here at the University of Idaho, is also an artist, and so here's her bead version of PhiX1 bacteriophage. Let's get to another example that's close to my own heart from Anolis lizards. This beautiful creature that you see before you is a brown anole, Anolis segrii. Anoles are a great model system for both ecology and evolution. One of the spectacular features that anoles have is this dewlap. It's a flap of skin under the neck of the lizard that can extend out as a display to whoever's watching. I'm going to tell you a story about anoles, and our story takes place in the Bahamas. Here's a brown anole lounging on a narrow perch in the Bahamas. You might envy the life of an island lizard, relaxing in the sun, running on branches, occasionally extending your dewlap. Yes, you have to eat bugs, but perhaps you could get over it to enjoy your island paradise. Well, it turns out that this idea of island paradises is completely overblown. And one of the reasons why these islands are not exactly paradise for anoles is these guys. This is a curly-tailed lizard, Lyocephalus carinatus. If you look at this species, you can see why they're called curly tails. And perhaps, if you look very closely, you can see a little bit of bloodlust in the lizard's eye, for he is after a meal, and only brown anoles will do. What I want to tell you about is an experiment carried out by Jonathan Lossos and his colleagues and published in 2006 in the journal Science that is a really good example of rapid evolution. Jonathan Lossos and his colleagues carried out an experiment on 12 islands in the Bahamas. On 6 of those islands, they introduced only brown anoles. On the other 6, they introduced both brown anoles and curly-tailed lizards. The goal of the experiment was to try to understand the effect that curly-tailed lizards, the predator, would have on the brown anoles, the prey. So we have 2 sets of islands, control islands, that are the black dots with just our brown anoles, and treatment islands, the white dots, where we have brown anoles and curly-tailed lizards. On those 2 types of islands, Lossos and colleagues tracked several aspects of the lizard's behavior and morphology. Here we have plotted just the proportion of time the lizard spends on the ground. So if that's 1, they would spend 100% of the time on the ground. 0, no percent of time on the ground, always up in the bushes and trees. And then the second plot, we see the perch diameter that the lizards are using. And at the start of the experiment, you can see that the control and treatment islands showed that the lizards were behaving exactly the same way, spending about 35% of their time on the ground and with perches that were about 2.5 centimeters wide. The scientists went back to the islands and observed the lizards 6 months later in November of 2003, and then a full year later in May of 2004. And so here we see those data. Immediately, they began to see differences between the control and treatment islands. In particular, lizards on the treatment islands started spending less and less time on the ground, all the way down to 5% at the one-year point. They also saw divergence in the perch diameters, where by the end of the experiment, treatment lizards were using much narrower perches than control lizards. If you're paying attention, you might notice that our control lizards are using wider and wider perches through time, and the reason for this is that these very small islands in the Bahamas are strongly affected by hurricanes. Those hurricanes wipe out lizards, which makes them great for doing experiments like this, but it also wipes out the larger vegetation. And so what we see here is the vegetation growing through time and the lizards responding by using broader perches. But in our treatment islands, we see that by the end of the experiment, lizards are using much narrower perches than lizards on our control islands. When these scientists measured evolutionary change in these lizards, they found something that was at first a bit surprising. So here we see two different selection gradients on the hind limbs of those lizards. And basically what we're seeing here is the strength and direction of natural selection on limb length of the lizards. Again, we have control islands as black, treatment islands as white. The dotted line is zero. That would indicate no selection. Above the dotted line would mean that selection is acting to increase the length of the limbs of the lizards. And a negative selection gradient below zero would mean that selection is acting to decrease the limb length of these lizards. And what the scientists found is that during the first 6 months of the experiment, there was relatively strong selection for longer hind limbs in these lizards. This makes good sense. We know that lizards with longer hind limbs can run faster than lizards with shorter hind limbs. And we also know that these lizards were being terrorized by predatory curly-tailed lizards. So probably the lizards were experiencing selection for longer hind limbs because lizards with longer hind limbs could run faster and were able to get away from the curly-tailed predators. However, during the second 6 months of the experiment, the lizards are no longer spending any time on the ground. They're always up in the trees. And when lizards are up in the trees, long limbs can be a detriment. In fact, it's better, if you're a lizard on a narrow perch, to have very short limbs. That gives you better balance and agility on these narrow perches. And so what we see in the second 6 months of this experiment is strong selection for shorter hind limbs in these anolis lizards. At first, the fast rodents with long legs survived, but later, short-legged lizards were favored for their agility on narrow perches. So, natural selection is strong. It's predictable if we know about organismal function, but it's not consistent. We have strong selection in one direction over 6 months, and then even stronger selection in the reverse direction over the next six-month period. And what we get from this pattern of evolutionary reversals is rapid short-term change, but many reversals. My claim is that this rapid evolution over short timescales that often doubles back on itself can help explain the scaling of evolutionary rates through time. We're going to use information from the Tree of Life to try to answer questions like this. So here we have a phylogeny. Again, this is from OneZoom, our fractal tree viewer, and we're going to learn about phylogenetic comparative methods. Phylogenetic comparative methods live at the intersection of population genetics, which shows us how alleles change from one generation to the next, quantitative genetics, which deals with how traits change over time, paleobiology, which is traditionally concerned itself with long-term patterns of changes in traits and diversity over millions of years, and phylogenetics, which seeks to understand how species are related to one another. Comparative methods relies on all of those fields to try to answer macroevolutionary questions. One of the core ideas that I want to convey, this at least in the first part of this course, is that phylogenetic trees are difficult to reconstruct because they are full of information. If we look at a tree like this, showing the relationships among living amphibian species, we can learn a lot about trait evolution and how speciation and extinction have affected this group through time. Or if we have a group, or for example, a phylogeny like this, showing the lineages that lead up to the modern day tetrapods, we can get a sense for the dynamics of evolution over deep time. So that's just a brief introduction to what we're going to do, and next time we'll start getting into the details of some of these methods.